Hi, this is Gene DiNapoli. Just want to let you know that your comments tonight might be shown on screen.
Gentlemen, Gene DiNapoli.
Hello, my friends, and welcome to episode 53 of Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli. Just like the first show, today I am still Gene DiNapoli, and right now, a word from our sponsors.
Hi, this is Francisco. Many people call me the creative CPA. If you need help with your taxes or financial matters, please email me your cell number and the best time and day to call you. You can email me at francisco@aol.com, and Cisco is spelled S-I-S-C-O, the creative CPA. It's that simple, that easy. Thank you.
Craving a cruise? Perhaps a gorgeous all-inclusive resort, magnificent destination weddings, and stunning unforgettable honeymoons. Dream Destinations Travels, a cruise planner franchisee, has all your travel and vacation ideas covered with great deals, extensive knowledge, and totally flexible payment plans. Group travel, be it family or friends, is our specialty. Never a charge to our clients and always free, no-obligation quotes. Check our website at sundrenchcruises.com or give us a call at the number above.
Little Italy Auto Repair at 628 Crescent Avenue in the true Little Italy of the Bronx. Over 50 years of automotive service excellence, ASE and state certified, offering all types of services to all types of cars. Discounts to first responders, military, Fordham University students and faculty. All work is done by Victorio with the highest level of quality possible. Telephone number is 718-933-2365 or visit his website at www.littleitalyautobronx.webs.com. That's Little Italy Auto Repair. Thank you to our sponsors. And if you're looking to advertise your business to a local, regional, or worldwide audience, send me a message. Maybe we can help you get the word out about your business or service to the masses. I want to let you know next week is Columbus Day. We will be off because we have a gig in Norwalk, Connecticut at the diner, the Norwalk Diner. We're celebrating their anniversary. So from 4 p.m. to 8 p.m., we'll be doing doo-wop and oldies and rock and roll as a gift from the Norwalk Diner to the customers. So that is next Monday. But the Monday after that, we're going to come back with a bang. Unfortunately, we don't have a flyer yet because our flyer person took ill for a couple of days. But on October 18th, we are coming back with Britain's eternal youngster, Peter Noon of Herman's Hermits, will be our guest on Monday, October 18th, 8 o'clock. So next week we're off. We're coming back with Peter Noon. Don't forget, we have our new T-shirt for sale, which helps us with the cost of the show. That's the New York Mr. Entertainment Gene DiNapoli T-shirt. I'm very proud to say it is going very well. So if you'd like a T-shirt, send me a message through Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli or the GeneDiNapoli.com website to order your shirt. So, for those of you that know, I have an Elvis show. And in my Elvis show, I have background singers. And I have a lovely lady named Valerie and a lovely lady named Diane. And a couple of years ago, Diane came to me and said, Gene, you know, I'm singing with a group now. See if you get us some work. And I said, okay. So we spoke. Unfortunately, the pandemic hit and we weren't able to put anything together. And then I started to do my due diligence on this group. And I said, wow, this group is not only a wonderful hit-making group, but there's other facets to this group and to this person, this guest of ours tonight, which I am so happy he's going to be spending the next 55 minutes with us to tell you about how he started the group, what the group's been up to, his paintings, his author work, just all over the place. This guy is a multitude of talent. So, ladies and gentlemen, the founding member, along with one other guy, which we'll introduce shortly as a thank you, drummer, songwriter, author. I don't know where to stop. From the original group, the Royal Teens, Big Hit, Short Shorts. Ladies and gentlemen, say hello to our guest, Mr. Tom Austin. Come on in, Tom.
Hey, how are you, Gene? Good to see you.
Hey, good to see you, man. How's everything?
Everything's good here in Jersey.
You're still in Jersey?
Yeah, I've been here all my life in Jersey. Yep.
Where are you gonna go, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Tom, I'm so glad when I give my guests the entire show, because I could really have three or four guests and give each one 10, 15 minutes. But after reading your bio and doing my homework, maybe one show is not enough. Because for a one-hit wonder, you have parlayed it into a 55-year career?
64.
I'm sorry, my math is off. Yeah. 64, starting in Fort Lee, New Jersey.
Yeah, 1956.
You were a young man, 16 years old, and you teamed up with another young guy, a little younger than you. Why don't you tell the story and introduce the other co-founder of the Royal Teens?
Well, I teamed up with another Jersey boy, and his name was Bobby Gaudio. Bob Gaudio, Four Seasons Bob Gaudio.
Yes.
We were working in a band. Well, we actually got asked to play in a band together. We didn't even know each other. And the band was in Hackensack. It was a guy named Joe Durante, good trumpet player. So we were out playing with him. Those fellows were quite a bit older than us. Bobby came from Bergenfield, New Jersey, and I came from Fort Lee, which we played each other in football. At that time, Bobby was playing football at Bergenfield. I was playing football at Fort Lee. We didn't know each other through that. We knew each other through music, though. And after a while, we decided to start our own band in 1956. And about the spring of 1957, we were playing at a Holy Trinity Church in a town called Coitsville, which was really in the borough of Fort Lee, north of the George Washington Bridge, a mile north of the George Washington Bridge. Mm. And we're playing at Father Geiger's CYO dance, okay? He had a sock hop going over there. And that night, they were going to have a vocal group come and sing. And the vocal group were the three friends, Joe Villa and the three friends. They had a hit record, Blanche, at the time. So Joe asked me, he says, can you guys back us up singing? You know, we said, yeah. Well, in the group, I just want to lay out that group. We had Bob Gaudio on piano. We had Billy Crandall on sax at 14 years old. Wow. Billy Crandall ended up being Buddy Randall in the Knickerbockers. and he wrote the hit Lies for the Knickerbockers. Okay. Right. But it's a cute little story, and I'll bring Billy back into the picture. So, and then we had Billy Dalton on guitar. Billy was a genius on guitar. And it was just the four of us. And Joe came up with the three friends, and they sang Blanche and a couple more, Chinese Tea Room or something. We played it, and they really, really liked our group, you know? Right. We were so naive. We didn't know anything.
Right. And now, Joe, just to go back just a second, Tom, you could claim Bob Gaudio, but Bob Gaudio was born in my borough of the Bronx, New York.
You're absolutely right. When I met him, he had moved to Jersey.
Yeah.
But I was over at his grandmother's house in the Bronx.
You were?
Oh, yeah. We used to play at Mount Carmel Church sometimes later on.
He came from the Grand Concourse.
Yeah. And we get a booking over to Mount Carmel Church. Once we played there with Sal Mineo. Can you imagine that?
So what do you mean with Sal Mineo? Sal Mineo was a musician?
He was a singer.
Sal
Mineo,
the actor.
Yes, Sal Mineo, the actor. He had a record out. I don't remember the name of it. But he was there one time. Now, what's interesting about that, Father Anastasia in Mount Carmel, right, at the time, and his brother was Albert Anastasia, who lived in Fort Lee, the head of Murder Incorporated.
Yes.
So when they said, go play at Mount Carmel, he said, yes, we'll be right there.
Oh, of course.
Well, anyway.
Of course you did. Of course you did.
That night, when we played at Holy Trinity, and Joe said to us, would you consider coming into New York with us and playing the background music for our next record with the three friends? And we said, oh, yeah, that'd be wonderful. You know, we'd love it. We got so excited, you know. So I stayed in touch. I was always the guy on the phone, you know, pushing it. Right. So I got a hold of Joe in New York. I called him up, and Joe said, can you come in on such and such a day to 1650 Broadway, you know? We'll go to our manager's office. That was room 1111. I remember, I have a good memory. Leo Rogers was their manager. And Leo had a bunch of acts, you know, he had all kinds of acts. And he even had Louis Premer at one time, you know, and stuff like that. So we go up there, and we were all excited. Gaudio's father drove us into the city. At that time, we didn't even have a driver's license. We were so young. Right. So we go into the city. And we meet with Leo, and Leo says, well, Leo's about 60 years old, and he was a sharpie, you know. He'd been through everything. He knew how to make a buck and take your buck along with it, you know. So that's Larry Qualiano up in the top, a top right guy. Right. Larry took Billy Crandall's place when Billy wasn't allowed to go on the road because he was only 40.
Right.
His father wouldn't let him. But that's me on top with hair. Bobby Gaudio down the left in the first row. Bill in the middle, and Billy Dalton on the right.
Right.
Yeah.
Wow, great. So you actually went into Manhattan to be a studio backing band at first.
Yes.
Did you read music?
Well, not none of us could. Some of us could, basically, but we had no experience reading music and playing. It was all, we just get up there and play, you know?
Okay.
And Bobby was, he could read. He took his lessons from a guy named Sal Mosca, a big jazz pianist, and Lenny Tristano in the city. I remember all these things, you know?
Yeah,
so he was a good reader.
Right. So at the time, Tom, the group was called the Royals?
The Royals, yes. We were at the Royals. Royal
team. Yeah. Now, why did you change the name to the Royal Teens? What was that issue about?
Well, after when we finally had a chance to do Short Shorts, you know, Short Shorts was an instrumental, you know, and there was no word in the English vocabulary called short shorts. They were those things the girls wore were cutoffs. But the day Bobby came up with an idea to write an instrumental because that. None of us could sing. All we did was play. So Bobby came up with this idea for an instrumental, and he started working on it and everything. And he and I were driving up Washington Avenue in Bergenfield when two girls walked out at Lumen's candy store down the street, they had cut off jeans so short. How could I was 17 then, I had a car, so I'm driving. I nearly crashed the car, you know. I said, you know what, let's call that new song Short Shorts. Wow. I didn't even know what they were called, but I said, Bobby said, we can't do that. I said, yes, we can do that. I said, yeah, it's a clean word. Oh, yeah, yeah. But very, you know, back in those days, you couldn't get away with very much. You know?
Well, you know what? You did it, and you recorded it, and it went to number three all over the country. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the biggest hits of the year, 1958, I believe. Yes. Here is Tom Austin on drums, Bob Gordy on piano, Short Shorts. Hit it, Gabe.
Man, dig that crazy chick.
Who wears short shorts?
So, who was the opening words done by?
Well, what happened was we went into the studio to record it, and in our minds, we had an instrumental. And that Leo guy, the manager, he said, where's the words? We said, we got no words, you know. And he had this girl named Diane Costello, and she was in his stable of talent, you know. And she was there, and... he said, well, I insist. You guys got to put some words to this, you know. So we all got off on the side, you know, and we started talking. And I said, I'll do the wolf whistle. Mm. And Billy Dalton, you do the thing on guitar. And I could still do the whistle, I think.
Wow. Okay.
That's not bad, right? And yesterday I had two implants that put in.
Oh.
So I this is the first time I tested the whistle with the two new implants.
And you did it live on my show. I'm so happy.
So now I'm probably going to pay the dentist, right?
So you did the wolf call.
Yeah, and Billy Dalton did the guitar.
Okay.
Billy Crandall, the sax player, 14-year-old, said, man, dig that crazy chick.
Wow.
Boom.
So what were you doing between 1956 and 58? You were doing dances, background recording. What were you doing?
Well, we were playing local dances. We were playing little politicians' gatherings and church dances. And in Fort Lee, we had a lot of clubs. We had the Jokers. We had the Jaguars. We had the Cherubs. We had the Colleens. And we were, like, very favored, you know. But I want to tell you one little cute little story. There was another group in Fort Lee who was older than us, and they were getting a lot of work. And they were called the Stardusters, okay? Mm. And they had everything sewn up. So there was going to be a battle of the bands at Father Donovan's CYO in Fort Lee. So we're all set to play, you know, and everything. We've been rehearsing and getting really ready for this, you know. And I said to the guys, I said, there's one thing that's going to push us over the top. It's not how we play, it's how we look. I said, let's go out and we'll rent white tuxedos with plaid collars. And, you know, we'll look so different. We'll look great. And that's half the show.
Right.
And we did that and we creamed them. We took over from then on. And our band got all the work from that point forward, you know.
You know, Tom, you told me a story before, which boggles my mind, but it shouldn't, because I've heard this many times over the past year. You were doing a high school dance on a Friday.
Correct.
And the next night, you wind up on a national tour because of Short Shorts. And I want you to tell our viewers and listeners who you appeared with. You were a high school band Friday.
Yeah.
And Saturday night, you were on stage with
Bill Haley in the Comets, Buddy Holly in the Crickets, Jerry Lee Lewis, the Everly Brothers, down in Tampa, Florida. Now, none of us ever had been on an airplane. So we thought this was a big deal just to get on an airplane and fly down there. And that whole week we played with those guys, and we went from being a local band into doing something on stage a lot better than when we started. It was Bill Haley's guys that took us under their wing a bit. And they said, you guys got a great band. You can play good. But on stage, you don't look good. You don't do anything. You just stand there like you're in a high school dance. They said, you got to move. So we started to move a bit, you know, and by the third or fourth day, the crowds were screaming for us. We were doing right. We were doing good.
Great. One of our viewers, Bob Ryan, said Start Moving was the name of the song by Sal Mineo.
Okay, good. I didn't remember it. Yeah.
I wish I knew that because I would have gotten it for this show.
Yeah.
But what I did do, Tom, was I picked up another song. It's funny how all the songs in the 50s almost had the same titles. And here was your second charted hit. This one, top 30, Believe Me, 1959. Hit it, Gabe.
Each night as I go wandering down the street of dreams, I think about the love we shared throughout our teenage years.
Wow.
Now, that last picture you had on there with the girl with the black hair?
Yeah.
That wasn't the Royal Teens. They took over our name at a later time. And every time you look up Believe Me, you'll see their picture.
Well, that was from YouTube. That wasn't our investigative work.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, Little Pigeon was another song by Sal Mineo.
Okay.
Thanks to Robin. Now, the girl in the group, in the pictures and on Short Shorts, was she part of the group, or did you just contract her to do this one or two things?
Well, she was more than contracted. What she did was she did Short Shorts with us. And then, you know, we started to get these terrific offers to go on these tours and everything with Buddy Holly. And then not only that, we were going all over the country by ourselves, playing ballrooms in the Midwest and everything like that. And she came with us, you know. She called herself Diana Lee then.
Okay.
And she was good. She was, what a great personality, good singer, you know. She was terrific, yeah.
Great. So when you did these contracted jobs all over the country, you only had two sides. What were the songs you were doing? What was she singing lead on?
Actually, she wasn't singing lead on anything.
Okay.
It was the group stuff. We would open with songs like Tequila,
okay,
and Honky Tonk.
Ah.
You know, we were a band, you know. And
so you
were
primarily an instrumental group.
That's what we were.
Gotcha.
And if you listen to Short Shorts, we weren't singing harmony. We were singing in unison. None of us could sing harmony at that time, you know. So we were just screaming and yelling and singing in unison.
One of your other songs, which I think should have been a bigger hit than it was, actually lent its name to an 80s hip-hop hit, and it's called Planet Rock. So this is Planet Rock by the Originals, the Royal Teens. Hit it, Gabe.
Oh,
Now, that was written by two of the guys in the group.
Yeah, that was the 14-year-old Billy Crandall in the beginning and Billy Dalton. Yes.
Did any of you have steady jobs at the time?
No, we were all in school. As a matter of fact, when Short Shorts came out, it was like it came out in the fall of 57 on the Power label. But I had just graduated high school, but Bobby was still in school. Billy was still in school. He was in the Bronx in New York in Old Hallows High School. Bobby was in Bergenfield. And they had to drop out of school to go on the road with Buddy Holly and everything.
Right.
And, you know, that was it. You know, what's an interesting story is maybe 10 years ago, Bobby called me up and he said, you know what? They want me to graduate from Bergenfield High School. Will you come up and be my guest speaker? You know, they're going to have a whole assembly in their gymnasium, in their auditorium, and they're going to give me an honorary diploma. I said, sure, I'd love to do that. And we went up there. Now, Bobby, at the time, he was probably 55, 60 years old, more than that. And we went up there, and he graduated. So he finally got his diploma.
Better late than never.
Yeah.
You know what boggles my mind, Tom, when I do these interviews with guys like you, is I'm amazed at the amount of talent on one show and how these people got paid. And eventually some became very well-to-do, but they all bought mansions. Like you said, you were on a show with Bill Haley, Jerry Lee Lewis, Buddy Holly. We're going to put up a picture right now. This was a tour, which I cannot believe this lineup. You got to tell me, how did this work? Look at this lineup. Chuck Berry, Frankie Avalon, the Egelegans, the Dan Liz, the Everly Brothers, Kalen Twins, Larry Williams, Jimmy Clanton, Ponytails, Teddy Randazzo, Cleftones, Bo Diddley, Royal Teens. How does a show like this happen? Did everybody do one song, two songs? What was the deal?
Well, we did like one or two songs. I think we probably did more than that. We probably did at least two songs.
Wow.
And we would start off at the Fox early in the morning, maybe for like the 10 o'clock in the morning show. Then there'd be another show at noon. Then there'd be another show like 2 or 3 in the afternoon. Another show at 5 or 6. Another show at 8 or 9. Wow. We were doing shows all day. Now you say, how could they afford to hire that many people?
Yeah.
You got to keep in mind, back in those days, there was a lot of payola going on. And they had a lot of publishing from a lot of these groups, including ourselves.
Royal Team.
And so we would always cooperate, you know. And, when they want us, we'd get paid something, but nothing too much, you know.
Yeah, but wait a minute, Tom. You have to get paid for your work. So if you weren't making on the records, were you at least making something on the live appearances?
Yes, that's where we made our money.
That's where you made your money.
Yes, that's where all the groups made their money, on the live appearances, because everybody was shortchanging everybody.
Right.
You know, we're all naive. Most of our parents didn't have the money to hire a lawyer. You know,
right.
That's really true. You know,
one of our viewers said that I made a mistake that that Planet Rock was not the flip side. This was the flip side. Hey, you know what? Big name button, Gabe. Let's do it. Hit it.
Club, and you aren't in the club.
So are you a bass singer? Are you a bass singer?
No, I think I'm just a baritone singer, you know.
So who did the bass?
Larry. That was Larry, the sax player, who took the place of Billy, because Billy's father, right from the beginning, took him out of the group. He can't go on the road. He's 14 years old, you know.
Okay.
So it was Larry Qualiano.
Okay.
And I had lunch with Larry about 6 months ago. Larry still looks good. Yeah.
Wow.
Larry was with us for years, you know. He a wonderful guy.
That's fabulous how you stayed in touch.
All
those. So Gordio's with you from 56.
Yes.
In Jersey Boys, we don't get a year when he joined the Seasons. When did he, was he still with you when he went to the Four Seasons, or did he leave you, or what was the timeline?
Well, I'll tell you what happened. Right from the beginning, when I was about 16, and I think I was just 16 or 17 before we had our first hit, my father said to me, you know, I wouldn't go into college. He said, I'm going to take you down to the Patterson Post Office, and you're going to have your choice of either going in the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, or the Marines.
Wow.
So I signed up for the Marines, okay, because my friends were going in the Marines. But the thing was, until I graduated high school, I didn't have to go. So all of a sudden, between that time I signed up, or my dad signed me in, till the time I was graduating high school, all of a sudden we've got a hit record.
Mm.
So I go back down there to Patterson. I said, can you get me a deferment? He said, well, let me look at your records. So he pulls out the applicant. He said, do you have a mother? I said, yeah, I got a mother. Well, she didn't sign you in. You're out if you want to be. I said, I do want to be. I want to go on the road with the band. He said, but I can tell you this. As soon as you become 18, you're going to get drafted. In those days, everybody 18, if you weren't in college, you were getting drafted. That's the way it was back then. So why I'm saying that is because you asked the question of when did Bobby go in the Four Seasons?
Yeah.
Well, I guess it was probably 1960, the end of 1960, when I had to, you know, I got called up and I had to go in the Army. You know, I went through the National Guard in the Army. And we all drifted apart. Everybody drifted apart. And then all of a sudden, Bobby meets up with the Four Seasons. Actually,
right.
We met them one time on the road when they were the Romans. You heard that they had a lot of names like the Four Lovers and the Romans and, of course, the Four Seasons. But they had a record called Coma Si Bella. And we were doing a little tour with Teddy Randazzo, Frankie Ford, I think it was the Kalin twins, and what's his name? Tommy DeVito didn't want to, you know, Coma Si Bella was an Italian song.
Yeah.
He didn't want the Italian song to interfere with this apple of your eye, you know, American type song. So he said, okay, we'll call ourselves the Romans. So we met them then, and I met Charlie Colillo then.
Oh!
And I wrote Charlie Colillo's life story, and it's out now.
And Charlie Colillo, the arranger?
Yes.
What? We didn't even know that, because we just had on the show a few weeks ago Chris Ruggiero,
just got finished with Charlie Colillo.
Yes. Yes. And we didn't speak about that.
Well, I can tell you a lot of stuff. You didn't talk about Charlie Colillo?
We had Charlie Colillo on the show, and he didn't even mention that there was a book being done.
Oh, how long ago was that?
3 weeks ago.
Oh, okay. Well, he's had his book out about a year and a half now. It's called Another Season, A Jersey Boy's Journey with the Four Seasons and Beyond.
Wow.
We had worked 2.5 years to get that book done. I did the writing. Charlie did the storytelling.
Mm.
And it's a wonderful book. He had 39 hits in the top 10.
More than anybody.
Lightning Striking Again, The Name Game, Sweet Caroline for Neil Diamond, After the Loving for Engelbert. You know, it goes on and on. Wichita Lineman. And, you know, our new song, which we put out this year, called Party Down the Jersey Shore. Do you have that there?
No.
Oh, my gosh, it's all over. It's playing up and down the East Coast. I was interviewed. You can get it on YouTube.
Yeah, well, we're going to push it. Party Down the Jersey Shore.
Yeah, the Royal Teens. And it's on YouTube, it's on iTunes and all.
Why did I not know this before we did this interview?
I don't know. I thought you did know it. I thought we talked about this.
No, we didn't.
Well, Charlie did the arrangement on it, and it's terrific.
I would have loved to have previewed it here for all
this. Is it too late to do it?
Yeah, because we got to get the video. We got to trans. But we're going to do another part, too. Don't worry about that.
Okay.
So you're traveling the country. You're an instrumental band. Planet Rock, big name button. Tell me about Shamrock. Because when I first heard it, I thought it was an Irish song.
Yeah, well, that was Billy Dalton. Billy Dalton was half Italian and half Irish. And he just thought it was a good idea. It was another instrumental.
Yeah.
If you think about it, very little lyrics, you know.
Right.
We do the Shamrock, you know. We just took the easy way out on a lot of things, you know.
Well, you know what? We're going to play a little bit of it, Tom. And you know what? You might think it was an easy way out, but to the trained ear, these are not easy songs. Shamrock, Gabe, hit it. Not too shabby, Tom. Not too shabby.
Shamrock. Yeah.
It's funny because you have Bob Gaudio in the Royal Teens. You did backing work for Joe Villa.
Yeah.
And then you wind up with a virtuoso, 14-year-old Al Cooper. How did that come about? Now, for those of you that don't know, Al Cooper – with the Blues Project and a founding member of one of my favorite groups, Blood, Sweat, and Tears. But also Bob Dylan's musical arranger on the recordings. How did Al Cooper go into your instrumental band?
Well, this is how it happened. Remember I mentioned before 1650 Broadway?
Yeah. Sure.
Well, the sun, as far as rock and roll went, the sun rose and set on 1650 Broadway. A lot of people talk about the Brill Building, but the Brill Building had much more mature music people than 1650 Broadway. All the newbies could only get their breaks at 1650 Broadway. And Al Cooper used to hang around room 1111, which was Leo's thing. And he'd go up to see George Goldner at Gong Records. Al was just a kid, but he was so gung-ho on doing stuff. And then Billy Dalton, our guitar player, he said, I'm going to quit. I'm going into college. I want to go to college. So he leaves the band, and we've got about 5 gigs to play. So we said to Al, you know, we heard Al play in room 1111. And we said, come on, Al, you want to play with us? Yeah. And so we took him on the road with us, and he was 14 or 15, and he didn't tell his parents where he was going. He was charged for kidnapping. it was amazing, really. And he played guitar with us, you know?
Right.
You know, I'd like to say he has a wonderful book out. It's been out for a long time. It's called Backstage Passes and Backstabbing Bastards. It's one of the best rock and roll books I ever read. What a talented guy, you know, and he and I talked together a lot. I got a cute little story if you want to hear it.
Absolutely. This is your stage, my friend.
Well, you know, Al was playing at BB King's.
Yeah.
And I had, when I went up to see Al up in Albany at the place called The Egg, That was a theater he's playing at.
We know the Egg. We just booked it to do shows up there.
Oh, that's a good place. Yeah.
Well, the Royal Teens are going to be on one of our shows in 2022.
Now we're talking. Now
surprise! That was the surprise I had for
you. That's it. You heard it first. So anyway, when I'm up there, Al gives me his book, Backstage Passes.
Yeah.
And he signs it. So I read it and everything, and I gave it to my son, Michael, who's an attorney. And at the time, he was just a young attorney. And he was working for a law office, you know, and he brought the book to work. And he had just started with that law firm. And his boss comes in and says, "Where's Al Cooper's book?" He said, "I'm a Al Cooper nut, man, you know. Can I see that book?" And he opens it, and it's got all nice things written about to me, you know, Tom Austin.
Wow.
So he says, "Oh, my God. Is that your father, Tom Austin?" And Michael says, "Yeah, that's my father." He said, "Could he get me an autographed picture of Al Cooper?" And my son said, "Yeah, I'll try. I'll ask him." So my son Michael, he says that he asked me. And I said, I called Al Cooper. And Al says, I asked Al, "Could I have a signed autographed copy, you know, and a picture?" I'm sorry. And he said, sure. What's it about?" And I said, "It's Michael's boss, the judge, you know." And he said, "Well, I'm going to be down B.B. King's. If this guy's such a big fan, bring him down to B.B. King's. I'll take him backstage. I'll make the guy really happy." And he did. We all went down to B.B. King's to see Al and the band play. And we brought the judge backstage, and Al was thrilled, you know.
You know, a funny side note, I was playing B.B. King's that same day. In the lounge in Lucille's. And I was supposed to go into Al's show.
Okay.
But I wound up doing overtime and I had to get back to the Bronx for another gig. But I was coming into that show.
He had that. I'm trying to think of the guitar play he had. Really great. I can't think of it, but he's a Jersey guy. Anyway, Al said to me, you know, backstage, he said, "You want to play Short Shorts with me?" I said, "I'd love to, but there's one problem. I'm a left-handed drummer."
Yeah.
And we're going to have to move the drums. Al said, "Then we can't do it, you know." But he wanted me to play. I would have loved to have played, but I understood I couldn't move those drums.
Right. You know, you mentioned Billy Crandall before, we mentioned the song Lies, and so many people think it's the Beatles.
Yeah.
But it's not. It's the Knickerbockers.
Knickerbockers with Lies, Can't Believe a Word You Say, you know?
Yeah. Did Billy get inspiration from the Beatles on that song?
Well, Billy was so progressive. Billy Crandall, or Buddy Randall, as he called himself, he was so far ahead of things in the world. You know, when he was 11 years old, there was a television show called Paul Whiteman's TV Teen Club, okay? And they would have all talent on that show, you know, all kids who could sing or play. But if you won, I think 14 weeks in a row, you would get a Nash Rambler. And Billy won 14 weeks in a row.
Come on.
Yeah. And they gave him a Nash Rambler, but he was only 11 years old.
What did he do with the car?
I don't know. I think he sold it. You know? But he was so funny, you know. He was great.
You know, looking over your discography, you were with four different record labels, right? You were ABC.
A lot of labels.
Mighty.
Power Label, ABC.
Mighty. Yeah. Capitol Mighty Records.
Capitol.
Why the change? I mean, it's not like, you know, people change record companies over a 30-year career. You guys are around for roughly 5 years.
And we never had a bunch of,
You never recorded an album either.
Never recorded an album. Now, the way it was set up, I think I know the management that we had looked at us like a bunch of sidemen. Mm-hmm. Whatever bucks they could make from us, that's what they did. Okay. Right. And all that stuff carried through to this day, you know.
Right.
Thank God my son's a lawyer, you know.
Yeah. Well, we're gonna get to your career after that. After we play a little bit of a new favorite of mine, Gabe. You know what? It's the talk of the town.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I can't show my face. Can't go any place. People stop and stare. It's so hard to bear.
That was Joe Villa. Okay.
Yeah. That was a Stan Applebaum arrangement. Stan was a big arranger for Capitol Records.
Sure.
And there were 14 violins on that session. So it was becoming, Joe was kind of like taking over the Royal Teens at the end, you know?
So Joe worked with you at the beginning and at the end.
Joe discovered our group.
Right.
He didn't play with us for 2 years. You know, we went out, we had Short Shorts and a few other records. He came on with a record we had called Hobby's Got a Girlfriend. Okay. That's when he first came on, when we were doing the Alan Freed show. Right. He would wear like a Buster Brown suit, and it was Hobby's Got a Girlfriend. No, I don't. Yes, you do. You know, I don't know if you know that, but that was a pretty good song. And he'd come out with short pants and a little Buster Brown shirt, and you know. And then Inga, Alan Freed's girlfriend, at the end, would come out and give him a big kiss. And
wow.
Now, picture this. We're doing about 8 shows a day for a week. That 48 kisses he got.
He couldn't get that today in the COVID world.
No, my gosh.
So you told us before that getting on a plane was the first big thrill for you after having a hit record. Tell us about this thrill, which we're going to put on the screen right now. Gabe, picture number 7, please. Tell us about being in a major motion picture with some of these stars, but also Julius LaRosa, you know, people like that. What was that like, Tom?
It was fantastic, you know. You know, things happen so fast when you have a hit record. Mm. For example, as soon as we had the hit record, McGregor Close called us up and said, if you guys wear Bermuda shorts on television, we'll give you, you know, they gave us, we got paid on that. We got quite a bit of money for wearing shorts. Men did not wear Bermuda shorts. That was kind of what we used to call fruity stuff. We said, we'll do anything for a buck. but we wore shorts on television, and we modeled for McGregor. You see, the interesting thing is Gordio is about 6'1". Okay. I'm 6'5". Larry was 6'4".
Wow.
Gordon was about 5'11". But we'd travel around, and they'd think we were a basketball team. We'd be in hotels and get on an elevator, and people would say, what college are you from? And we say, you know, we couldn't say anything. But we were all very tall in the Royal Teens, you know?
That's incredible. Because you normally don't see rock and roll stars that tall, because they do go into sports.
Pretty much.
Tell us about when, I don't want to say it like this, but when the British invasion came in and you started to see less work than before. You had gone into the Marines, you said?
No, I ended up in the Army.
You ended up in the Army?
Yeah.
You did your...
I came out. I only had to go active. I think it was about 6 months active. And then, then I had to go 6 years, the remainder of 6 years, to meetings and going away in the summers and all that kind of stuff, you know.
Right. But the Royal Teens was put on a back burner for a while.
Yes.
And you became an author and an artist. And in addition to the website, theroyalteens.com, your works of artistry is on the TomAustinGallery.com website.
Yes. Now,
can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I'm what they call a fine artist. You know, I do oil paintings. In fact, I have five of my paintings in the permanent collection of the Coast Guard in Washington. I don't know. I just had some talent in art, and it came out, you know, and around the 90s it started, you know. And as a matter of fact, I did, I was commissioned by Bob Gordy on Frankie Valli to do the official painting of the Jersey Boys show.
Wow.
That they gave the prints to the stars of the show when they were going to leave the show. And then a cute little story is a fellow named Joe Grano. Frankie Valli and Bobby wanted to give Joe Grano a Christmas present. So the key of that painting is I put the first cars owned by the Four Seasons in the painting.
Mm.
The painting is, I think it's 54th Street and the August Wilson Theater where the show's playing. And it snowed that week, you know, and the cars were all in the snow and everything, but it was Bob Gordio's 56 Olds convertible. Charlie Colillo was in the group then, and that was a 53 Pontiac. Frankie Valli had a 57 Chrysler 300. Tommy DeVito had, I think it was a 56 Oldsmobile, okay? So I painted all those cars in there, and I painted the red and white 57 Ford I owned down the street, and that's the car Gordio and I were driving in when we saw the girls with short shorts. And
wow.
I painted Dalton's car in there.
Wow.
So it was a wow. When they saw that, they just fell in love with the painting. So they commissioned me. They said, we want to do one for Joe Grano. Joe Grano was the producer of the show.
Right.
And he was a Green Beret, you know. So I said, what do you want me to do? Paint the same picture? No. I want you to paint the same picture, but put Joe Grano's name up on the wall and put this. So do another painting.
Right.
Complete new other painting. So I said, really? So it was so lucrative. I said, oh boy, I'll be glad to. Then when Joe Grano was gifted the painting from Frankie Valli, Kevin Kinsella's wife calls me up. Kevin was another producer of the show in California. And the wife said, I want to surprise my husband. Can you do the painting again and put his first car in it? I said, wow, yeah, I'll do it. So that painting was absolutely terrific. You know?
Tom, by any chance, do you have a painting readily available next to you that you could show us? Or
I'll get one off the wall. You got a minute?
We got about a minute, yeah. I want to show our viewers firsthand.
Okay.
Sure.
Hang
sure. On. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're enjoying our show, please make comments and check out theroyalteens.com on their website, because starting next year with the opening up of concerts again, I have a feeling the Royal Teens will be coming to a theater and a nightclub and maybe a casino near you. And maybe you could write to your local promoters and say what a great song Short Shorts is, and you'd like to see the Royal Teens in your area. We're waiting for Tom now to show us personally one of his paintings. But right now we're going to play a little bit of their last charted hit with you. Gabe, hit it, buddy, with you.
It will just be with you. When I smile, just like.
Thank you.
Here we go.
Let's see this. Okay, so which picture is this, Tom?
This is the original Jersey Boys painting I did.
Wow.
And that's the cars I was telling you about.
Yes, absolutely. Look at that gorgeous work of art. That's gorgeous. That's yep. Now, Tom, are these prints available for purchase?
Sure.
On Tom,
you can get
TomAustinGallery.com.
Yeah, but better than that, just give him my phone number, 201-825-7653.
Gabe, could you put that in the comments? Anybody that would like a print or would like to commission Tom Austin to do a personal work of art, give us that number again.
201-825-7653.
We're going to put that up on the screen, Tom. Royalteens.com, TomAustinGallery.com. Tom, for a guy that had one hit, you have made a career out of it.
Well, yeah.
Your song was also featured in commercials. Of course, the Jersey Boys play. Just so many different things. TV commercials. Going back to 1970. It's a song that will live on in infamy. And I'm glad you got to do this with us, because our viewers and our listeners got to know the Royal Teens just a little better than they knew about them.
Thank you.
What do you got planned? You know what? I want to show a new picture of the new Royal Teens. Gabe, put up picture number 9, please. This is the new incarnation. You got my sax player, Johnny, over there.
Yep.
You got Diane. John Serio. Yep, John Serio plays sax with me. Diane Tiberi is our vocalist. There you are in the back. Who's the other guys?
Well, that's Lenny Triratola behind Diane to her right. And that's Nick Civic, the keyboard player. And then there's Dave Dalbaro and Eddie Rosanico. I want to say this. Sure. Eddie Rosanico, Dave Dalbaro, and Lenny Triratola were in the Royal Teens 40 years ago.
Ah.
With Joe Villa when he was doing it.
So a little comeback.
It's like a homecoming. We got some of the guys back, you know?
That's great. It's like a homecoming show.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And that band is tough. It's a good band, you know?
Well, you know what? We got a feeling we're going to see you on the circuit. I got to tell you, for a guy that was stuck in his house for 18 months, you look great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for taking the time out to be with us. We hope you had as much fun doing this as we did. And we're going to stay in touch, my friend. And may God bless you. Thank you for your service.
And thank you. Thank you, Gene.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we love, as entertainers love, let's give our guest, Mr. Tom Austin, a big round of applause. Thank you, Thomas. Thank you.
Thank you, Gene. Appreciate it.
Well, you got it.
Adios.
Adios. Wow. What a show, huh, ladies and gentlemen? Did you learn a little bit about the Royal Teens? I know I did. Don't forget, next week we're off. Go and enjoy other shows, but make sure you come back on Monday, October 18th, when we will have the ever youthful, always smiling, and wonderful sounding Mr. Peter Noon of Herman's Hermits. Please join my YouTube channel at Gene DiNapoli, Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli on Facebook. Click the subscribe button and also check us out on the website, GeneDiNapoli.com. Hope you had fun. Thanks to our producer, Gabe. Until next time we see you, good night. God bless, and God bless America.